¿Qué me hizo usted? Que la quiero volver a ver y volverla a besar. Yo te pasé a buscar, buscar.
Es que la bella queda contigo, con nadie más la consigo. Es tu grito y no me olvido.
Tengo reserva el hotel, pero con esta gana no vamos a llegar. Somos dos desesperados, por eso no tuvimos que parquear. Atrás no espera el asiento, tú eres una aventura cuando te desnudo. Tengo reserva el hotel, pero con esta gana no vamos a llegar. Somos dos.
Un safari, todos miran cómo bailas. Hoy tú andas con un animal. Mami, mami, con tu party. Este party es un safari. Todos miran cómo bailas.
Good afternoon, everybody. How are you guys doing? How is everybody doing today? How are you guys doing? How are you guys feeling? Let me know in the chat. I'm watching, I'm paying attention. How is everybody doing? It's the first workshop of the year for me. Happy New Year, happy 2022 to everybody. This is probably going to be the first time I'm seeing a lot of you that are coming into today's workshop. So let me know in the chat. Let me know how you guys are doing. All right, let me know how you guys are doing. Let me know how you guys are feeling. How are you guys feeling about getting started in building your digital presence, expanding your brand, learning how to be found digitally beyond what we know of just social media? How are we feeling about learning about the different ways to monetize digitally so we as artists and creatives can get different types of income coming in, right? So you guys let me know. I need you guys to be active in the chat because the more energy that you guys give me, that helps me deliver the content that we're going to be doing and delivering for you guys today. So let me know in the chat how everybody is doing. Let me know if you guys are excited. Let me know if you're ready. Let me know, you know, what types of things you guys need assistance on, what you're looking for, because most importantly, I want you guys to get some new ideas, fresh ideas, questions answered. I want you to approach this entire workshop with an open mind, all right? Wonderful. Dennis says, everything is blessed. That's what I like to hear. Ira says, she gave me the rock sign. I love it. I love it. I love it. So If this is your first time tuning into a workshop from me, Keron Rose, let me give you guys a bit of an intro. Let me give you guys a bit of an intro. You guys ready? Let's.
Ladies and gentlemen, cue it up. Get ready. Coming to the stage by way of Trinidad and Tobago, he's one of the top thought leaders in the Caribbean region. He works with entrepreneurs in building their digital presence and teaching them how to monetize their platforms. He's the host of the popular Digipreneur FM podcast. And quite frankly, when it comes to navigating the digital age, there is no one better. Please welcome the Digiboss, Mr. Keron Rose.
I love it. And you know what? I'm always on wildness. I like to get everybody engaged. I want you guys to have a good time. We got to play just a snippet. This is the Music TT and Ministry of Trade Reverb Workshop. So we gotta kick it off with one of Trinidad and Tobago's very own soca artists just to set the mood, just to set the vibe, right? Yo!
Drink water and mind my business. Drink water and mind my business. I go drink water and mind my business.
Who is drinking water and minding their business all 2022?
Who, me? I don't watch people mad. I'm looking for house and land. Who, me? I don't watch people
too. Yo, alright. I think the mood has been set. I think the vibe has been set. I can get this party started. I can do what we all came here to do, right? So, like I said, I just like to set the vibe. I like to set the tone. I want you guys to know that, you know, this is never going to be a boring experience as long as I'm in front of the camera talking to you guys. I want you guys engaged. I want you guys learning and most of all, having fun, right? All right. So, perfect. So, let me share my screen and let's get this party started. Hold on one second, folks. Let me just share my screen. Right. So hold on. I'm just getting the admin team. Admin team, I need you. Wonderful. There we go. We're in the game. All right. So this workshop is all about the journey of discoverability and monetization. All right, admin, if you guys can give me a full screen on this just so they can see. Perfect. All right, so we're going to be learning all about how our content, our brands, the things that we are putting out into the public space, how can they be found beyond just typical social media, and what are some monetization strategies that we're going to be able to do, right? So a little bit about me. What I do is I work with Caribbean entrepreneurs and businesses to build their business online and learn how to integrate digital and e-commerce tools and platforms into their business. Listen, I will always stress to creatives. Creatives need to think of themselves as a business. As the great Jay-Z once said, I'm not a businessman. Let me hand him my business. Damn, right? Keep that in mind. I've worked with companies like B-Mobile, Flow, Digicel, Huawei, Samsung, Loop Caribbean, Eastern Credit Union, Scotiabank, and WePay. And I'm super, super passionate about educating the Caribbean community and people of color and learning how to become self-reliant through building digitally and mastering e-commerce. I'm a smartphone junkie. I love my animals, my favorite pets. Listen, I'm always talking about my Rottweiler, my two cats, my bearded dragon. Listen, I love my animals. And if you follow my IG stories, you guys know I'm always showcasing the different animals that I run into, especially as I didn't grow up in Trinidad. When I'm seeing all of these animals, I'm like, wow, this is like Discovery Channel stuff. But anyways, I love it. So what are we going to be looking into today? Well, we're going to be taking a look into the soca artist digital footprint. And I won't just limit it to soca artists. This is, again, all about creators from all industries. But I'm going to be showcasing some soca artists just to give you guys some real life examples. Then we're going to be diving into key platforms and components you need integrated into your brand so you guys can take notes and start working on some of these things to start to build around your brand, right? And last but not least, we're going to be talking about your brand ecosystem and monetization, because your brand, your name, your skill set, what you're trying to build needs to be a fully functioning ecosystem that has, you know, content, ways people can interact with you, your products or services. And in this case, it's our art, it's our music, it's that type of stuff. All these things need to work well together and feed into one, to feed into each other. And that's ideally what builds our brands, right? So we're going to be rounding off with that. So today, it is not enough to have the talent. You need to learn how to transform yourself into a business and sought after brand. Now, a couple of months ago, Flow Business did a series, and one of the artists that they had invited to speak on the topic of building their brand as a business as an artist was Allison Hines. And reason I'm bringing this up is because in the interview, she was asked, what was that one thing you wish you knew as an up-and-coming artist? What was that one thing you wish you knew that you knew now? And she was like, because she got started so early, you know, she realized talent wasn't enough. That was the least of her concerns. She wished she learned and focused on learning the business side of the music industry and the business of building her brand, because that would have saved her a lot of money and a lot of headache. So again, we need, as creatives, we need to start thinking of ourselves as a business. And I understand, you know, a lot of us don't want to think of ourselves or want to think of the business aspect. We want to just focus on being the creative. We want to just focus on being the creative. But you at least need, even if you are outsourcing, you're working with people that are handling those things, you at least need to know enough that the wool is not going to get pulled over. You understand what is happening for your brand. You're understanding the why things are happening within your brand, even if you have other people working for you. And if you're in the case where, again, you're just starting out and you don't have somebody working for you, you need to learn as much about the business side or building of your business as just as much as you focusing on your craft. So I hope that makes sense. I just took a quick look at the chat. Melly says the iguanas and the iguanas. Yes, the iguanas. Oh boy. So here's some bad news. Nobody is coming to save you. However, here is some great news. For the first time ever, you have all of the tools and the platforms you need to build a brand without needing a backing from anybody. If you can allow yourself to integrate this at a very core level, this can be one of the greatest sources of motivation for you. One of the joys that I have in what I do is that, again, we have so many tools at our disposal. And the more I've learned about the tools that have allowed me to build my brand, the more freeing it has become, because there's so many ways that we can automate, that we can digitize, so that we as a solo act or a solopreneur, we can appear like we are a whole team or a whole company just because of a lot of the tools and platforms that we're able to employ to make us seem bigger or make us look and feel bigger, right? And again, we're going to be diving into a lot of those things today, things that you guys could be using to help build your brand. And then maybe you attract that person who says, oh my God, I need to work with this person. And let me figure out how I could work with them to take them to the next level. So we're going to be starting off with a live demo. And I want you guys to kind of pay attention with the artist that we are going to Google. I want you guys to look and see, you know, what is happening when we Google these artists. Now, this is all about learning. This is not to put anybody down or do anything. This is just where I'm showing you guys things that we need to be taking a look at when we're building our brand digitally. So let's start off with, oh God, I feel to play that song again, you know, Drink Water and Mind My Business. All right, so we've Googled Patrice. Let's take a look and see what comes up on the first page with Patrice, right? So we see some videos. She has her music videos. Her videos are showing up first thing. If we scroll down, let's take a look to see what else is coming up for her. We see Patrice's Instagram, a Wikipedia page, a Twitter page, Loop News, and Facebook. Yeah, and Facebook, right? All right, that's what comes up for Patrice on the first page. We're going to look at some other artists, and I want you guys to see what is there, what is missing, and then we're going to talk about it, right? Next artist we're going to look at is the guy, the man himself, Voice the Artiste. Let's take a look. Voice, first thing that pops up is his IG. Then we got some videos, YouTube, a Guardian article, Facebook, Twitter, and Soca Lyrics. All right, that's what pops up for Voice. Keep in mind what you guys are seeing and what you guys are not seeing. And remember, the whole point of this workshop is to teach you guys about building your discoverability, right? Next up, let's look at Bungie Garland. So Bungie, Ian Antonio Alvarez, Bungie Garland. First thing that pops up is his Wikipedia. Then it's videos. Then it is Twitter. Then it's Instagram, Facebook, Spotify, VP Records, right? All right, that's what pops up for Bungie. Keep in mind what is being shown and what is there. All right, now we're going to throw in the last artist. We're going to throw in, I would try to say Nyla's signature, but I don't want to burst your eardrums. You know where she's like, it's Nyla. I would have done it in her voice, but I'm not trying to scare you guys away now. All right. So first thing that pops up is her IG. Second thing that pops up is her website. Third is her Facebook, then Wikipedia, and then her YouTube, and then some other links to other platforms, right? All right. So let me know in the chat. If we're talking about building your digital presence, if we're talking about being discoverable, right? What do you think when we looked at some of those artists? What do you think is missing if we are talking about building our digital presence? What is missing from the majority of the artists that we looked at? Let me know in the chat. My eyes are on the chat. I look in to see who was paying attention. Let me see who is paying and who is looking. What do you guys think is missing? If we're talking about building your digital presence, we looked at a few artists. What types of things do you, what did you see that was missing? Somebody said, Wiki is huge. You see, Melly, you follow me too much, Melly. Yeah, Melly got it. Dennis got it. Personal websites, right. Somewhere to buy their work. Tumhari Saki, somewhere to buy their work. Okay, perfect. Aspire, website, content, consistency. Listen, that's perfect. So Melly, Dennis, Tumhari, Aspire, yo, you, that's exactly it. That is exactly it. When we look at your artists, right? One of the most important digital asset that you need is your website. Because what happens is, right? If we go look at anybody else, let's just look at Bungie, right? Everything about Bungie is not on a platform that he owns. He owns nothing in regards to his digital footprint. So if Facebook decided to shut Bungie Garland down, that's two of his first five links gone. Facebook, Instagram, gone. If Spotify decided to shut him down, Spotify, that's gone. The day he's no longer signed to VP Records, that link is gone. Bungie essentially has no control over his digital footprint. Everything is being told from somebody else's perspective. When you have your website is your digital home. That is your digital real estate. That's your piece of land. That is the one area of the internet that you control, right? So if anything happens, let's just say you post something that violates community rules or whatever, or somebody, people are hating on you and they report your post, and they, and Instagram or Facebook or any social media platform removes your content or suspends your account, right? Nobody can do that to your website. So you always want to have your website, because you want that to be like what Nyla has, right? Where you want it to have, you want it to be one of the first thing that shows up. Now, ideally, you want your website to be the first thing that shows up, because that is your digital home. That is the hub. That is where everybody can go to get information about you, your bio, purchase from you, learn about you. They can follow you. They can subscribe to your email list, your notification list. And we're going to get into some of those things as well. But that is the most important digital real estate. And what you guys are going to notice as well is when you Google, everything that comes up is a link to a website. Everything that comes up is a link to a website or a link to a video on a YouTube channel, right? So, but mainly links to websites. Go just look, right? The majority of everything that shows up is links to websites. So content on your website is still the most looked at content, because it's the number one type of content. Web content is the number one type of content that shows up on the largest search engine platform, which is Google. And it's the same thing if we were to go over to Bing, right? And we're going to get into a couple of strategies, because when you, even when you have audio content or video content, you still want to embed those things on your website so that when people are Googling, they can hit that link and go to your website and still consume that content, right? So websites is the main digital asset that is missing from the majority of all of our Caribbean artists, right? There's only one or two artists that actually have one. But then if we take a closer look, right? So let me see. Is that on my next slide? Okay, let me just pull this up, right? If we go into Nyla's website, right? If we go into Nyla's website, and this is, again, even when you have a website, artist, you want to make sure that your websites actually work. So if we go to Nyla's website, the minute we start clicking on links, watch what's going to happen. All of a sudden, the website's broken. So even when you have this most important digital asset, your website has to work. It is a platform that collects data that also shows to the world who you are. And if people are looking to do business with you, if labels are looking to sign you, like, they come to your website first and they look at you and they say, wow, this person has their entire brand put together, right? You don't know who is looking for you and when. So you don't want, when people are actually going to look for you, now I got to go and find you on somewhere else when I wanted to come to one place, get a nice view of who you are, what you are about, and then reach out to you, whether via email, because email is still the channel that people are going to reach out to you for the important stuff, right? We know that when we reach out to people on social media, half the time it goes into the spam and whatnot. So people are still going to email you for a lot of these things, right? But a lot of the content on her platform just doesn't work. So we need to be mindful of, even when we have our website, that our websites are up to date and they are working, right? That being said, let me just get right back into it. All right. So as I said, no control. Having no control over your digital footprint is a major problem. When you are not in control over your digital presence, you are reliant on the platforms you do not own in order to grow your brand or to be discovered. If your social media accounts get hacked or they get shut down, you have lost your only mechanism to engage with your community. You are not treating your brand like a business and building out the necessary components to collect and track data for your audience. And I'm going to show you guys some of the types of data that we can, well, once our website set up correctly, what types of data that we can collect from our audience to make better decisions, right? So let's dive into some of the key platforms and components that we need to really build our digital presence or to have a solid foundation. So for one, it's your own website. This is your digital home, as I said, and your most important asset. Get your domain name, own your digital real estate, push your content here in order to increase global visibility. We know that when we create content on social media, we're subjected to the algorithms. Last time I checked, Instagram, Facebook, they're still showing your content to 0.04% of your audience. So a minuscule amount of people actually see the content that you push on social media, right? What you want is that you want to have all that content getting pushed out through your website. So when people are searching for things, they're searching for you. You increase the longevity of the content because it lives on your website. We know that after a few days on social media, it gets buried. Nobody going back a week, 2 weeks to go and look at your old content on Instagram. We rarely ever do that unless it's for a very specific purpose. But on your website, again, if we're Googling things, we can see your content popping up and we can go and check it out, right? Next up, a CRM, a customer relationship manager integrated into your website. Now, what that does, this is a very nice tool, and it's imperative that you have it integrated into your website because this is going to collect some in-depth data on your audience. You need to understand what channels are bringing you your audience, and I'm going to give you guys an example of that in the next slide. I'm going to do a live demonstration with my CRM, and I'm going to show you guys how my content gets tracked, all right? Then Google Search Console, Bing Webmaster. So these, again, these are some tools and components you wanna be able to have, and you want to connect them into your website because it's gonna collect data for you and you as the business. Remember, we're not just thinking of ourselves as a creative. We need to think of ourselves as a business. We need to be thinking ourselves as a digital marketer as well, so that we can help get our craft shown to the world, right? So Google Search Console, Bing Webmaster. Integrating these two tools will allow you to have a deep understanding of how your brand is performing on the top two search engines, how you are being found and where you are being searched. Search engine traffic tops social media traffic, right? So if you are only on social media, then you are only found on that platform because all social media is a silo, right? The search engines, along with your website, supersede just a silo with you on social media, right? So if you don't have a website, you're also missing out on being found via the search engines. And all the traffic that passes through Google, Bing, Yahoo, that tops all the traffic that happens on social media. So if you're only on Instagram, you can only be found on that one, in that one silo, right? You want to be able to plant your seeds into different aspects. So you're not just reliant on just social media. You want to have your websites. That way the search engines can help increase your discoverability as well. Melly said, Bing is still alive. Yes, Melly. Whilst, here's a fun fact for you guys. Whilst Google owns a 92% market share of search engines, Bing has 6% of the entire search engine traffic around the world. 6% of like 10 billion is still a hell of a lot of traffic, right? So you still want to be able, again, and once you have your website, Bing is still going to find your website and index it. And that way, when people are using Bing, right, because people still have their Windows computers, so when they're conducting searches, the first thing it usually goes to is it gives you a Bing search on Windows computers, right? So Bing is still available. You can still be found via Bing. You could still be found via Yahoo. But if you don't have certain assets, then you won't even be found. You won't get that additional look, that additional discovery that those things come with, right? Last but not least, your email and notification list collections. So you want to treat your brand as an artist, as a business, as I've said. Your job has to be to take the traffic you get from platforms like social media, platforms that you do not own, and turn them into subscribers on your own platform that you do own. And you could also get data from them. So here's a good example, right? I make YouTube videos. I put them out on YouTube. I don't own YouTube, but YouTube is a search engine, so we get good traffic from them, right? Now, one of the strategies that I like to do is once I push out a video, once I push out a podcast, I would then send out an email blast to people that have subscribed to my platform, I would embed the YouTube video or embed the podcast episode. And once I send out that email blast, that email is going to go out to everybody who has subscribed to me, right? Versus when we post our content on any other platform, we are subjected to the algorithms, and the algorithms are not pushing our content to everybody, right? So when we get people coming to our website and we get them to subscribe to our email list, we get them to subscribe to our push notifications. And notifications is, you know, when you have those apps and the app sends you a notification and you could pull down from the top and you could see all your notifications. Our websites are able to do that as well. So people can subscribe to notifications on our website. And anytime we post content, it gets pushed out, right? That's something that does not happen for us on the other platforms. We don't really have control over that, but we have control over the push notifications on our website. So when you create content, you want to be getting it out to your email list. You want to be pushing it out to the people who have subscribed to your notification list, because you know for sure they're going to receive it. And you're not just relying on the algorithms from social media to get your stuff out there, because it's a pay-to-play game, unfortunately. Unless we're spending money boosting content, we know it's not. It's only going to go to a small percent of the people who follow us, right? So let me give you guys an example of some of the data that my website collects, right? So let me pull up my HubSpot, and I'm going to pull up my Google Search Console. So these are two tools that are connected to my website that give me some really nifty data, all right? And I like to use myself as an example. That way you guys can have real data to look at. And we're not just talking from theoretics, right? We're not just theorizing what should happen and what is not happening, right? So in the last 3 months, my website, KeronRose.com, has garnered 66,000 impressions on Google. Now, these two metrics, the most important metric here is impressions. And impressions on Google or on Bing is entirely different than impressions on social media. Now, here's why. An impression on social media is when we're scrolling past, when we're on our feeds and we're just scrolling, anytime a piece of content, as we're scrolling, anytime it shows up in our feed and we scroll past it, that counts as an impression. It showed up in our feed. That counts as an impression. When you watch a video, most platforms at bare minimum require you to watch 3 seconds of a video in order to register as an impression. That video could have been 5 minutes long. That means nothing. That does not mean I watched the video, right? I might have just sneezed and 3 seconds of that video passed and that registered as an impression, right? Or as a view. So impressions on social media don't really have no merit, because that does not mean somebody actually looked at your stuff. The difference with impressions from your Google Search Console or your Bing Webmaster is, in order for an impression to happen, somebody would have had to have conducted a search. Somebody needed to type in something. Somebody had to do an action. And because your website or your content was relevant, Google or Bing or Yahoo presented it to the person as an option for them to click through to their query. So impressions on search engines are 1,000 times more important, because you need to know, what are your people searching for? What are they looking for? And then you need to create the right content or optimize your pages the right way in order to show up for those people conducting those searches. So the fact that we could even get over 66,000 impressions means that my website showed up in 66,000 search results. So people conducted searches, Keron Rose was there as a result, right? Now, your click-through rates are always going to be bad, because what Google has started to do is, you know, when you conduct a Google search, right? Let me give you an example. If I type in, who is the Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, I don't have to click on anything to get the answer. Google is doing an even better job clipping out information from websites and giving us the information so we don't have to click on anything, right? So I know who the prime minister is. I didn't have to click on anything. That means that I conducted a search, but I did not click through because I got the information. So the more we create content and Google starts to clip out the information and serve it to people, people don't always have to go through to our website. Even with our videos, like Google is doing a better job at, you know, displaying our videos right in the search result pages just to make it easier for people to get to the content or get the information that they want. So from one perspective, if you have a website, your click-through rates, you're looking at that and you're like, man, that's terrible. But the global average for click-through rates is anywhere between 3% and 10% based on your industry, right? But the impressions is the most important thing, because if you're not showing up in searches, then that means you're not creating the right content or you're not optimizing your platforms enough to show up in anybody's searches. So I hope that makes a little bit of sense. But here's the fun stuff, right? Here's the fun stuff. So when we scroll down to queries, what queries is? Anything that people are typing into Google and I'm showing up for as a result, Google is tracking all those things, or Google Search Console is tracking all those things. And these are the things that people are typing into Google where I am being shown as a result, right? So this is super important information, because you need to know, how are you being found? What are people doing? What is the action people are taking in order for you to be showing up in the results? So when we do our market research, and I'm not going to get into that, that's a completely different workshop. But when we do our market research, we learn what are people searching for, and then we go and create the right content, right? And that is the basis for being found, is understanding what people want, right? And then learning how to kind of create the right content, or learning how to optimize it the right way. That way we can be found for the searches, because you could be creating content, but if you're creating content nobody is searching for, nobody's looking for, then you're not going to show up as a search result, right? So you kind of need to mix. I need to know what people are searching for and then create that content. And then when my platform has a buzz, when people are naturally bookmarking my site, I could start to introduce a lot of content that they might not be searching for. And you have that balance and you find that mix, all right? So I'm always looking at, what do people want within my space? Then I create that content in order for me to be found. So again, for me, I teach people about online business, being discoverable, e-commerce, creating products to monetize. So something like PayPal. PayPal is a mechanism that people use in order to make payments online or to purchase from people's websites online. So guess what? People are searching for PayPal. I'm going to create content on PayPal. That falls in my garden. I'm going to talk about it. That way, people, when they're Googling PayPal, I show up. JMMB, I have no business with JMMB, right? But JMMB adds a piece of the puzzle to getting paid online, so I'm going to talk about them. You know, Paywise is an old payment platform. I don't know if they're still around, but I talk about them, right? SEO Trinidad, prepaid credit cards. Does PayPal work in Trinidad? You're going to see that all of these things, people are typing in these queries into Google, and your boy is showing up as a result. So the more I learn what do people want within my niche or within my space or within my passion, right? I create that content, and that increases the opportunities for me to be discovered, right? And as I said, impressions are more important here, because people have to type something in. They got to do an action in order for you to show up, right? So let me take it a step further. We can also see the top performing pages on our website, right? So we can see which one of our websites are getting a lot of the traction, right? So look at that. Getting paid with PayPal and Trinidad and Tobago, 17,000. This has shown up 17,000 times, right? So this isn't people scrolling through on Instagram. This is people have done 17,000 plus searches. And my website, this page has shown up in the results, right? If we look at some more. Second, why everyone needs a JMMB account? Because I'll talk about PayPal in this one, right? 5,000 searches, right? So again, people are doing an action in order for these web pages or these things to show up, right? Then you can also see what countries are looking for you, right? So what countries are conducting the searches? So when you look at your demographics on social media, they show you what countries of the audience have actually come to your social media platform. They've landed on your social media platform, right? But this helps us with prospecting. This helps us with understanding the general audience, right? So these people are conducting searches on Google. So the countries that are conducting the searches that my website has shown up for has been predominantly Trinidad and Tobago, then the US, then Canada, India. So let's just say if I wanted to go out to, you know, if I wanted to go out to the Philippines or Brazil, right? One of the tactics I could use to increase showing up in those countries is I could have something on my website that allows to toggle the language. So somebody, if I see India showing up a lot, coming to my website, I can then, you know, set up my website to toggle to India. That way they have no problems reading in their own language. Google Translate helps, but Google Translate isn't always accurate. There are better tools that we could integrate that ensure that everything is on point, right? But again, so these are all the countries that are conducting Google searches where my content is showing up as the answer or the result to their question or query. This is really powerful stuff, right? And if I go over to my HubSpot, so I'm going to show you guys why a CRM is super important for building our brands and understanding, you know, where our audience is, where these guys are coming from. And it's also going to show us some really good insights into, you know, what platforms are giving us the content or giving us the traffic. So let me just quickly pull this up. All right. Bam, 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 bam. Let's take a look. So I am looking at, these are people who have come to my website and they have subscribed to my website, right? Let me just do, do, do. All right. So take a look at some of these columns, right? First page seen means this is the very first page on my website that they have seen. This is typically going to be the page that has brought this person to your website, right? Because people are not just going to your homepage. They're Googling questions, they're Googling queries. And when you pop up as a result, if somebody says, hey, I want to make $10,000 a month, and I have a blog or I have a video that says, here's how you can make $10,000 a month, right? Then somebody can click on that, and that would be considered the first page that was shown to them that brought them to the website. So if we look, dropshipping in the Caribbean, how to set up your Visa debit card, my homepage, getting paid with PayPal in Trinidad and Tobago, right? First referring site, once it's captured, will show you which platform brought them to your website. So I love to see search engines, because this means that somebody conducted a search, they put in a question and a query, my page came up as a result with one of my pieces of content, they clicked on it, they said, oh my God, this guy is brilliant, right? They said, this guy is brilliant, I gotta go and follow this guy. And then they subscribed to my email list and they automatically got entered into my CRM. My CRM is HubSpot. And HubSpot is showing me that this person found me via Google. This person, where's Melly? Melly, come back in the chat. Melly said, does anybody use Bing? Is Bing still alive? Look, Melly. Melly, look. Bing. Right? Bing is still there. Bing is alive and present. You get traffic from Bing, right? You can get subscribers from Bing, right? Now, social media. So Linktree is a link that I use on my TikTok and also on my Instagram as well. So Linktree is also bringing me traffic. Look, LinkedIn. So it's going to show you where all these people are coming from, right? It's going to show you where these people found you. And these are the people who have subscribed to your email list. They have subscribed to your website. So it's going to track all of this for you. And at the end of the month, or you could do it day by day, but you could generate a report to say which platform worked for you the best. Was it Facebook? Was it LinkedIn? Was it Google? Was it Bing? Right? It's going to show you, and you could generate a report every single month to show you exactly which platforms are bringing you the traffic. So you know which platforms are working best for you, but guess what? You can also see which piece of content has brought you the most subscribers. You could generate that report at the end of the month as well. And all of this information is captured automatically once it's connected to your website, all right? So we can see, you know, this is showing us the performance of our website on Google. So people are Googling things. They're Googling things like PayPal Trinidad, and Keron Rose is showing up and they're clicking on his website. And once they click on his website and they realize, oh my God, this guy is amazing. This guy is great. Let me subscribe to the email list. Then they get entered into our CRM, our HubSpot, and HubSpot will say, yo, big man, this person found you from Linktree, or this person found you from Google, right? And HubSpot is also going to track all of the activity each subscribers do on your website, so you can understand how people are engaging with your brand. I'll give you a really good example of this, right? So remember, I told you guys, you need to think of yourself as a business, right? So what I do on a daily basis, I do like once a week or twice or every 2 weeks, right? I would look to see who has subscribed to my platform with a business email. Once I see that they have a business email, I would go and I would check to see, you know, where did they find me? I can look and I could see all of the activity that they've done, because this is a timeline. This shows you all the activity they have done on your website, right? It'll track everything. And then I could then go and say to, I could jump on LinkedIn. I could go on LinkedIn and I could type in that person's name, right? And if I could spell his name correctly. Right. I can go pull him up. I can see who that person is, right? That person is a VP in Wholesale Marketing for Latin America. That's the parent company to Flow, right? That is somebody who has subscribed to my website, right? So as a creative, what you want to be looking for is, what if that music exec? What if you scroll through your contacts and somebody at Sony had subscribed to your email list? And then you could see all of the things that they are looking at on your website. And then you could go jump on LinkedIn, or you could go and find them on another social media platform. My first place to go is to check them out on LinkedIn, because again, I'm a business. I know other businesses or other people within big corporations are always looking at my stuff, right? I want to see who these people are, and that can be my way of entering into a conversation with people I want to work with. So now that I know that Chris Coles, the VP of International Wholesale Markets of Liberty Latin America, I can now reach out to him and say, Wagwan, Chris, Wagwan, what are you for? Now, I wouldn't say that. But you understand where I'm coming from, right? It's all about now being strategic about understanding, you know, where your audience is coming from, who is watching you. And then this is where your outbound marketing is going to come into play. If I know that people are engaging or they're watching my content, because we all know, we all do it, right? We all jump on social media and we watch people and we never comment. Yeah, you know, you're one of them people. And we know that everybody does it to us. But there are some people who just can't connect with you or engage with you publicly, but they like what you do. And they will subscribe to your email list, right? Or subscribe to your website. And then you're going to be able to see all the things that they're looking at. So you can have a healthy private conversation with them. But you would have never have known that if you didn't have these things connected. You could even go as far with this connected, where one of the tools on HubSpot called Prospects, this actually shows you all of the companies who have been visiting your platform. So take a look. Ministry of Community Development has been on your boy's page as late as 2:16 today. Now, I would go through my contact list, people who have subscribed to my website, and I would see, did anybody register with an email from Ministry of Community Development? I would, if I don't see anybody, if I do see anybody, I would also go on LinkedIn and I would type in Ministry of Community Development, right? And I would go and see who is connected or who from that ministry is on LinkedIn. Am I connected to any one of these people? And again, I can see, I can have an idea what brought them to, that's a bad example. Hold on. Let me see. Did it capture for this? So like Digicel, originally what brought someone from Digicel to my website was on drop shipping, right? So the prospect tool kind of gives you an idea because it tracks companies' IP or government bodies' IP addresses. Again, you as the business, you as a creative, you want to have a good idea as to who is looking at you. You have no idea if record labels are looking at you. You have no idea if art museums are looking at you. You have no idea who is looking at you, right? So these types of tools that are integrated within our websites give us an idea as to who is looking at us. And then we can kind of start to now be a little bit more strategic with our outreach, all right? Melly asks, unknown keywords, SSL. SSL is really, that's the lock on your website. Usually that comes up if it's unable to track one of the sources as to where it came from. Don't put too much stock in that, but definitely focus more on when it's, did I lose it? Definitely focus more on, you know, first page scene and, you know, what is the first platform that that referred the person to your website, all right? Let us continue. So if I were to ask you, do you know how to find where in the world your audience is? How can you find out, you know, who is searching for you? You know, do you know where in the world that person is? All right. Let me give you guys a quick little demonstration. Today is all about, we're going to be doing a lot of live demos so you guys can see, you know, why it's important, especially as you guys are starting up, why it's important that you understand or learn digital marketing, because it can help you tremendously in building your digital presence. Preach Kid asks, is HubSpot a free tool? Yes, it's a freemium tool. Everything I'm showing you guys today is free tools. I'm not showing you any paid tools. What I showed you guys in HubSpot, all of that stuff is free, right? I haven't showed you anything paid within HubSpot. So Google Trends is another free tool that I use when I'm trying to understand my audience, right? So if I go over to Google Trends and I click on Explore, all right, I'm not going to dive too deep into Google Trends. I would do that in a different type of workshop. What I want to show you guys is I want you guys to look at this from understanding, you know, where people are conducting Google searches from. So let me give you guys an example, right? My filters right now are set on worldwide and the past 12 months. And I could change that. I could change worldwide to any country in the world. And this would give me the data from that specific country as to who is conducting that Google search. And I could also change the time period, right? I could also change the time period from the last 5 years, 90 days, last year, 30 days, and come down the line. But I'm going to leave it right now at worldwide past 12 months. And I'm only focusing on Google Trends does a lot of things. Today, I'm only focusing on the demographics, all right? So if I type in Masha Montano, what I want to know and what this is going to show me is where in the world, what countries are conducting Google searches for the keyword or the search word Masha Montano. And this gives us an idea as to where our audience is in the world that are conducting a Google search on us, right? Now, let's have a little bit of fun. Before I hit enter, give me the top three countries. Let me know in the chat. What three countries do you think are searching for Masha Montano the most? What three countries do you guys think is searching for Masha Montano the most? Let me see in the chat. Get them fingers ready. What three countries do you guys think are searching for Masha Montano the most? And oh God, nobody cheat. Please, nobody cheat. All right. Trinbago, USA, and India. That's a very good guess. Asia, Japan, India, Trinidad. All right, good guess. USA, Canada, England, lovely. Trinidad, USA, UK, lovely. Japan, Germany, Trinidad, TT, USA, India. Those are some very good guesses. And obviously, we're thinking about, you know, Masha. We're thinking about, you know, who he tends to appeal to. And where are some of the places in the world that have expressed a great appreciation for the Soca King? Right? Wonderful. Let's hit enter. Let's see what are the top countries that are Googling Masha Montano. All right? Bam. Here we go. Look at that. Number one over the last year is Trinidad and Tobago. Number two is Dominica. Number three is Saint Martin. Number four is Antigua and Barbuda. Number five is Saint Lucia, SLU. These are the top five countries searching for the Soca King. All right, let's take a look at 6 through 10. Belize, Guyana, Barbados, Jamrock, Suriname. All right, now. If you know that these are the places that are searching for you the most, when we start to do our market research, we could start to dive in. We could look at Dominica. We could look into a deeper dive and look at, you know, what is Dominica searching for in relation to Masha Montano? And that would give us a greater understanding as to what Dominica wants from Masha Montano, right? And that their team, Masha's marketing team, could then start to create the right content. If they know what they want, if they're saying, you know, let's just say if somebody, if we look at the data and the data said something like Masha Montano acoustic, right? Let's just say that was one of the queries that were popping up in our research. Now, if I'm part of the Masha Montano team, I would say, yo, dog, Dominica is number two on that's Googling you. And one of the top things they're looking for is acoustics from you. So here's what we go do. Let us do a private acoustic digital vibes and target Dominica. All right? You home, you have a little studio home. Let me go live. Let's target Dominica. So let's point our ads to Dominica and let us do an acoustic show because clearly Dominica loves the acoustic. Now, that's just an example of how we would use that data, right? Oh, Lord. Is the session going to be saved and reposted after? I think, yeah, Kyle, let me just answer that real quickly. It's going to be on YouTube. So as, you know, as we're done, you could always go back because it's on YouTube and it's on Facebook. So it's already live. It's already there. You guys could always go back and watch it, right? But yeah. That's an idea as to how I would look at this information and say, Dominica, okay, let's do a deeper dive. Dominica, what does Dominica want from Masha Montano? Look through the data. Oh, they like acoustics. And that's not, I haven't done the research, right? I'm just giving you guys an example. If I seen that, at that point, I could make the recommendation to say, hey, let's do a session, an acoustic session, right, with you. Let's do some ads. Let's target Dominica. Let's do it live. Let's do it digital. And that way we can earn some money through a digital platform, right? All right. So let me do another one, right? Let us do, I'm gonna do Trinidad and Tobago, right? Now, before I hit enter on this, What are the top five cities in Trinidad and Tobago do you guys think Googling Marshall Montano? Get those fingers ready. What are the top five cities in Trinidad and Tobago do you guys think are Googling Marshall Montano? Oy. Let me see them things coming in. Top five cities Googling Marshall Montano. I'm looking at the chat. I'm waiting for a couple of those things to come in. Let's see. Let's see. People are real thinking, boy. I ain't see one come in yet. All right. Well, I'm going to go ahead, right? So we're going to look at when we change the country, we are going to see. All right. So some of them come in. Oh, let me go back. All right. Let's see. Port of Spain, San Fernando, Diego Martin, Port of Spain, Arima, POS, San Fernando, Arima, Chaguanas, Diego, Port of Spain, Lily, how could be Miami? Miami not in Trinidad? Port of Spain, San Fernando, Arima, Chaguanas, Point. All right, that's good. So when we change the country, right? So when we leave it on worldwide, it's going to show us the countries that are Googling Marshall Montano. When we change to the specific country, it's then going to give us the top cities Googling that particular keyword. So let's change it to Trinidad and Tobago and look at this. These are the top five cities Googling Marshall Montano. Port of Spain, Chaguanas, San Juan, Cuvée, and Diego Martin. Now, if you are doing ads, right? If your team is doing ads in that specific country, instead of targeting all of Trinidad and Tobago, you can target these specific cities, right? Because if they're the ones searching for you, you can get greater return on your ad spend by targeting the people that are actively conducting that search for you. So that's a great way to kind of get a better ROI and have an idea as to, again, one, who is searching for you. So another thing that I would do is, let's just say if he wanted to do a meet and greet, right? He could look at this and say, well, you know what? Well, Port of Spain's a given. You know, you'll always score doing a meet and greet in Port of Spain. But I could look at this and be like, you know, where else are people Googling? Where else are they Googling me from? Why don't I do a meet and greet there? So I could look at and see Cuba and be like, all right, let me go do a meet and greet in Cuba. Let me go do a meet and greet in Diego or San Juan or Chaguanas. So again, knowing where your audience is allows you to be strategic with some of the things that you do. Whether it's you're doing ads and you want to target specific cities, or if you want to do some offline activities, but you have no idea, or you want to do something a bit out of the box rather than just doing Port of Spain or the main city in your country, you know, look and see where people are Googling you from, and then you could do some offline activities in those cities, right? Otherwise, you might not have ever have thought about going and doing something offline in those particular cities, right? Splendid. So let me get back to the presentation. All right. So let's take a look at this. I got another question for you guys. Now we're going to have time for a Q&A after the fact. So I want to get through it. Keep your questions handy, have them there. So when we get into the Q&A time, you have those questions for me, right? So here's a question for you guys. How long do you think on average your Instagram posts are shown to your audience? We are referring to the shelf life of your content. This is where, you know, the bulk of the engagement or interaction happens on your Instagram posts. How long do you think the average shelf life is for your Instagram posts? Give it to me in days. How many days? How long? Yanni says 24 hours. All right, no problem. Who else? 48 hours. Melly says 3 to 5 seconds. Lord, Melly is rough. Rough out here, Melly. Dennis says 2 days. All right, cool. Let 2 to 3 days, 1 day, 1 day, 1 day. All right, nice. Let's take a look. So how long does content on social media last? The answers might shock you.
So Twitter, the average shelf life on Twitter is 18 minutes, meaning that the bulk of your interaction for your tweet will happen during the first 18 minutes of you making that post, right? Unless that thing has taken off. But the average post, 18 minutes. Facebook, 5 hours, with 75% of the traction happening within the first 2.5 hours after posting. So if you don't get the bulk of your traction within the first 2.5 hours, then Facebook is just burying that in the Facebook graveyard for nobody to see. They're not showing anybody that post after the fact, right? Instagram. People said 48 hours. Yeah, y'all got it for Instagram, right? 48 hours with Instagram, with 75% of your traction happening within that window. Stats also show that Instagram can take up to 12 hours to get traction. So it lasts for about 2 days. The bulk of your engagement will happen within 2 days, but Instagram does take up to 12 hours to really get that traction because their algorithms are just all over the place, right? They show it at all times of the day. Sometimes they're showing your post a day later. So that's why they say, 48 hours, but the bulk of your traction is going to happen within the first 12 hours. So if your content scores on IG within that first 12 hours, then they're going to be showing it constantly even more over the next 48 hours, right? But if it doesn't happen within that 12 hours, then yeah, it's out the window. YouTube, the average shelf life for YouTube content is 20 days. So that's why you want to make sure that all of your video content, whether it's long form or if you guys are doing TikTok videos or reels, you also want to make sure you get that content onto YouTube Shorts, because YouTube has a heck of a lot longer shelf life for content than any other social media platform, because YouTube is a search engine and connected to Google. So when you guys are doing reels, when you're doing TikTok videos, you want to make sure a great tactic would be to get that content over to YouTube Shorts as well, right? Pinterest. Oh, what is Pinterest? 4 months. Pinterest content lasting for over 4 months before Pinterest buries you in the graveyard. I gotta use Pinterest now. Pinterest is a great source of traffic to your platform. I haven't integrated Pinterest into my strategy. I might. Anytime I see that stat, I'm always like, yo, I might need to start using Pinterest. But sometimes you don't want to be on every single platform. You want to be on as many platforms as you specifically can handle. I just feel like Pinterest has not been something I could add to my plate as yet. But Pinterest content lasts 4+ months before burying the content. And then take a look at the last one, blogs or web content, because we could embed audio files, we could embed videos onto our website, so, and then we could have written blogs, right? But web content lasts over 2 years, well over 2 years, because of the search engines. Anytime somebody Googles something, once you do your homework and you know what people want and you're creating the right content or optimizing it the right way so that the search engines match your content to people who are conducting the searches, then your content on your website will live on forever. What I should have shown you guys is the content I did on KeronRose.com on PayPal and JMB. That's things I did in 2019. And that is still showing up as my number one traffic driver to my platforms. 2+ years, going on 3 years. And that is still things that is driving traffic and getting me subscribers to my email list, right? So that is the beautiful thing. That is the beautiful thing about making content on your website. Carlina asked about shelf life on TikTok. I don't have that handy. I don't have that handy. I might check, and if you follow me on social media, I might do an updated post on this and include TikTok, but I don't have that offhand. So why does web content last longer? And I kind of just jumped the gun and said that, right? Google, being the largest search engine and indexer of content, gets over 16 billion searches per day. Comparatively, the biggest search engine, Facebook, or sorry, not the biggest search engine, but the biggest social media platform, Facebook, gets 1.5 billion searches per day on Facebook. So when people go on Facebook and they go to search and they conduct a search on Facebook, right? They're looking for somebody, they're looking for, they're typically looking for somebody, looking for a page. Searches, Facebook has 1.5 billion searches per day, but Google gets over 16 billion searches per day. So more people are conducting searches on this, on Google, than on the number one social media platform, which is Facebook. All right. So again, you guys want to make sure that you have your digital asset, your website there, and your content on your platform to increase the opportunity for people to find you, right? The key now for artists and creatives is to start learning how to build their digital homes, aka their website, create content, learn search engine optimization in order to be found and extend the life of the content you are creating. Why create content if it's dead in 18 minutes or dead in 48 hours or even on YouTube, dead in 20 days, right? You want to make sure that you guys give yourself the best possible chance at being discovered, right? Currently, the only social media channels being indexed by the search engines is Twitter, and also TikTok just signed an agreement with Google to start indexing TikTok videos. So TikTok videos are now going to be showing up in the search results pages, right? So if you're not on TikTok, right, TikTok is doing more for you helping you, you know, build your visibility organically, because their organic traffic on TikTok is great right now, but they're also going to be indexed by Google, and TikTok videos are showing up on Google search result pages. So you definitely want to include TikTok as a part of your strategy. All right. What platforms can you start focusing on in order to grow your brand? Well, let's take a look. Here are some platforms that I definitely recommend. Start with web content. So get your website. The more content you guys create and you optimize your website, the longer it lasts and the further your content reaches. So all those videos that you guys are putting out, the music, the art, that should be content on your website. Even though you're putting it on social media, get it on your website, because it has a much higher chance of being found, and the longevity of it is astronomically better than you posting it on social media for it to die within a couple of days, right? Remember, YouTube is a search engine. That's why it has the longevity that it does. But in terms of Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, these things have a very short window of engagement, right? And Carliana, I don't have it offhand, but if I'm not mistaken, it definitely is close to Twitter. Because the bulk of the engagement is within the first 15 minutes, but don't 100% quote me, but I do remember seeing in my searches, it's close to Twitter at around 15 minutes. If you don't get the traffic within the first 50 minutes on TikTok, it is kind of buried, but that can also change, because that deal that TikTok did with Google is going to be able to extend the life. And that is also, you know, now starting to happen. Right? TikTok videos are only now being indexed by Google. So give it, you know, 2 to 3 months and we might see that information change a little bit. But right now it's similar to Twitter. Second up, podcasts. Podcast directories like Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, CastBox, all of these podcast directories have their own search engines and algorithms, and they have the highest consumption rates for audio content. They are also indexed by the search engines as well. So again, if you're a DJ making mixes, you want to make sure you get your mixes and stuff on Apple Podcasts or Spotify and whatnot, because audio podcast directories have a higher consumption rate, right? So they're also being indexed by the search engines. You know, Google Podcasts shows up Apple Podcasts is constantly recommending different podcasts on their network, and they're the largest podcast directory. So you want your audio podcast, your audio content showing up. Here's the thing. If you're not a DJ, right, or you're not a podcaster, what I would do is I would learn how to become a podcaster if I'm a creative, and I would talk about my niche. So if I'm a photographer, I would start a podcast talking about photography, and I would talk about all aspects of photography, right? Give people different ways to engage with you. That way, you're not only relying on getting booked as a photographer. Now, if you have a poppin' photography podcast, companies can look at you and be like, "Oh, you know, we don't need you as a photographer, but yo, can we sponsor an episode? Or can we, you know, can we pay you to plug us? You know, can we work with you?" This opens you up for different types of monetization. A photography company that's selling the equipment, they could come to you and be like, "Yo, can we sponsor an episode?" Right? Or, "Hey, can we pay you to interview us so that we can talk about podcasts, so we can talk about photography equipment?" Right? So I would look at my respective skill set, and I would start a podcast, and I would talk about the industry. I would interview other people in the space. I would interview other companies or other stakeholders within that niche. And that can be one, a source of traffic, because people can find you via the podcast. And then that's how they could find your website or find your social media platforms and follow you. But that could also be how they book you for gigs because they love the conversation that you did. And that opens you up to another form of revenue, because there's multiple ways to get paid through a podcast that you'd be able to now start to earn some money, right? Next up for discoverability, YouTube. YouTube is a search engine. I've said it a couple of times already. So learning how to create the right content and optimize it will also allow you to gain further traction, right? Next, Google My Business. I recommend everybody go and claim your Google My Business directory right now. It's free. It's that section on the Google search results that has all of your information, right? Go claim your listing, because you're going to be able to post content. You could post photos. You could post videos. You can post events, right? You could post links to content. You could take out a booking link. And people can also message you on Google My Business. And Google My Business gives you a lot of data as to how people found you, if they've contacted you. There's a lot of information that Google Business gives you, right? Google My Business is also the key platform that controls how you show up on things like Google Maps, right? And on Google Search. So you want to get your content out there. That is a beautiful hack for your content to get more traction and be more discovered, all right? Google My Business. Claim your listing immediately. It's free. Next, live streaming. Live video gets the biggest algorithm push on any social media platform. Learn how to use social media event sections on your live stream to gain further traffic. I'm not talking about Instagram. Instagram is the one place. Instagram is the easiest place to go live, but it's the worst for discoverability. Because there is no dedicated section that they use to push live stream content. So, for example, when you schedule a Facebook Live, Facebook has Facebook events that they then push out all across their algorithms to people who would be interested in that live event. And people can subscribe to watch that live event. YouTube does the same thing. When you schedule a live on YouTube, YouTube pushes that out across YouTube to anybody that would want it, right? And again, because everybody's so focused on live video and they're prioritizing it, they're pushing it out even further. Same thing with LinkedIn. LinkedIn is pushing out their event. So you could schedule a live stream on LinkedIn and they're pushing it out to people who has a high chance of connecting with you that would enjoy your content. They're getting that out there. So you have way more benefits to doing lives on LinkedIn, Facebook, and YouTube than you do on Instagram. While Instagram is great because it's easy, there's not much headache, you just go live and there you go, that doesn't do much for you in the long run for discoverability. There's better platforms for live streaming. And Eventbrite, this is kind of piggybacking off of live stream. Eventbrite has its own algorithm and it pushes events through all of their channels, so their apps, their websites, their push notifications, their email lists. Eventbrite is constantly pushing events to people because they're learning what people like and they're pushing the events to them. So if you have a live event that you're doing, right, you can create the event on Eventbrite and just take advantage of Eventbrite pushing out the free event to people. And then when people register, they're going to get the link to click on for your YouTube live or your Zoom live or whatever. And again, that's another way to aid in your discoverability. Eventbrite is a great platform to push out free live streams. Use it because you never know what traffic you're going to get from Eventbrite when you're doing your live streams, but you're only going to get that link for people to click on to click into a live stream if you do something like a YouTube live or a Facebook live or Zoom, right? You're not going to get that link from Instagram. So you definitely want to focus on some of the other platforms. They all help in your discoverability, right? All right, so let's look at some marketing data we can kind of pull to use for our own benefit. And our test subject is going to be Freetown Collective. I'm almost done. I got a few minutes left and then we're going to be diving into the Q&A. So you guys make sure to have those questions answered. Let me know if you guys are still here. Jump in the chat. Let me know if you're still here. Let me know if we're going good. You could drop some flames. You could let me know that you're still here. Let me wake you guys. Let me wake you guys up, right? I want to make sure that you guys are still here, that you're still with me, that we're going good, right? Yanni says, we here, we locked in, we inside. Dennis dropped some flames. Afia, I dance, she dance, she dance, right? Let me know if you guys are still here. All right, LOL, we're very much informed. No need to rush the finish. Everybody peeping. All right. That's something I like. All right. So let me go. Let me take a sip of my chlorophyll infused water for some energy purposes. All right. Let's go. So we're going to look at Freetown Collective as our test subject. So let me start with their website. Oh, no. Before we get to the website. When we Google Freetown Collective, what I love two things immediately from Freetown Collective. I love that their website is the first thing that pops up for them. Because remember, your website is your digital hub. This is where everybody should go to be able to get all the information about you, right? That should be the first thing that shows up. That should outrank everything. That should outrank LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook. That should outrank everything. That should be the first thing that shows up, your website. The second thing I love about Freetown's website is they're using a branded domain name. They're not using a .com. They're using wearefreetown.love. .love is a branded domain name. I love the fact that they did not go with the traditional .com. They went with a branded domain name. So you guys can get, there's over 400 different types of branded domain names. I'll give you guys an example, right? For my academy or for my podcast is digipreneur.fm, right? Digipreneur.fm, that's the name of my podcast, right? So I got .fm instead of .com. For my academy, I have digipreneur.academy rather than digipreneur.com, right? So you can do those kind of funky things for branding purposes, and they add some touch. They add a touch of class. They add a touch of pizzazz to your brand, right? So let's go over to Freetown's website. Now, right out the gate, Freetown's website just is immersive. Right out the gate, it's immersive. They have a well-thought-out video, the words Freetown welcome residents, that is nice, clean, clear. It's a beautiful thing to open up the website, right? And if you go through their website is super, super clean. I love what they have done from the aesthetics of their website. This makes me want to learn more about Freetown Collective, right? If I'm somebody looking to work with Freetown Collective, when I come to their platform, I'm thinking to myself, this is a brand that clearly is serious about their brand. We can work with these people, right? So they have their, what do they have? They have a bit, they have the pictures of the members, right? They have the pictures of the members. They have a little bio, you know, a little blurb about who they are. They got a little video to click on to play, right? To get a little bit more insights as to who they are. They got a little breakdown as to who are the members of Freetown Collective. Then they got, you know, some of the music. And we'll click on these things and see how they work. But they got some of the music attached. And then they have a section for events, but they don't have any events right now. But they have a section for events, right? So we can see, and you can also support. There's a link to click on to support Freetown Collective, right? And then look, they have their social medias. You can connect with them. You can also subscribe to their email list. You could book them. They have their contact, right? This is a beautifully well done website. Now let's take a bit of a dive deeper. So when we look at, you know, what they have on their website, their bio, they have a video. I like that. If we click on each individual person, we get a bit of a blurb about each individual person. I like that. So we get to learn more about who Freetown Collective is, right? What I would like to see is I would love to see more monetization options on their website. And we're going to be diving into some of the monetization options available to us. But from looking at it, they're not monetizing anything on their website. It's just a kind of a placeholder for the bio about them, right? If we click on these links, let's see. All right, we can actually play their songs, but it's going to take us to an Apple Music. So we might not have Apple Music, right? So I might not link to Apple Music because you could be like, I now have to take an extra step of taking this thing and going to YouTube to listen to it, rather than, you know, linking to Apple Music. But I understand they're trying to push it to iTunes Store so that they could, you know, encourage people to purchase. So I kind of understand that. But when you're linking to certain apps that people might not have, it could discourage people from going the extra step, which is finding that same song and going to YouTube. So when you're building out your platform and you're linking to music, the safest bet is to always link to YouTube. That way, you know, people can listen to the song. Because ideally, if they're going to support you, they're going to go to iTunes. They're going to go purchase the album anyway. I mean, you could have links to go and purchase it. But again, just things to keep in mind. That's not a knock to them. Just things to keep in mind. I don't have Apple Music. I can't play that song, right? So I would have to go take the extra step and go to YouTube, right? If we look. So let me look at, I have a couple of tools. Now these tools, I'm just using these tools to kind of show you a bit more on the deeper side of your website, right? Now, when I use one of my tools to kind of look at the traffic that their website gets, their traffic isn't high, right? So it's a greatly designed website, but even when you design a good website, that doesn't mean you're going to get traffic. You have to learn how to get traffic to your website. The number one way to get traffic to your website is by creating content. So if we go back to my website and we look at the query section, look at all the things people are typing in to get to my website. These things don't have my name in it. It's just a lot of different content I've created based on the research that people are looking for. Then I create the content, and that is how people find me and they come back to the website, right? When we look at their website, go back to them, one key thing that is missing, there's no content. There is zero content on their website. There's no content. Outside of these, outside of the music section, these three links. Now, this is cool because if you have new music, you can put this in this section to highlight that new music. But they don't have content coming on their website. So all of the videos that they're creating, there is no section. There is no web content. There is no blog section. The content that they're just posting on YouTube should be posted to their website. Embed the video as a blog with a little bit of a write-up, and that write-up could talk about, you know, why they did this song, a little bit of history, how they came up with it. They can add some substance to that, and that could be content, right? So I would take one of the songs, I would embed it on the website in the blog section, and I would have a little bit of a write-up to give people a bit of the story about the song, and then they can click on it to listen to it. But the more content that you are creating, that is how you're going to get traffic to your website. So when your website is a static website, so they don't create no content on their website, there's no reason for people to keep coming back to your website because it's never changed. It hasn't changed. There's no reason for me to come here, right? I've seen it once. I've subscribed to your email list. After that, there's no reason for me to come back. There's no content. Google and the search engines, part of their ranking metrics is if a website isn't updating with new content, they bury you in page 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? They bury you. Unless someone is typing your name and then they're going to show up, they're going to show your name or they're going to show your website, but you're not going to be found for anything outside of just your name, right? And that shows when we look at the traffic, they get very low traffic to their website. So it's a beautifully designed website, but they're not getting traffic to the website. So if we look down, the top pages that are being found on Google are their homepage and the second page, which is wearefreetown.loveeverything, right? So I'd actually have to go to that to see what that is, because this is the second page that is showing up. This is the second page that is showing up for them. So this looks like this is a cause that they are a part of. But this is the second page that is getting traffic for them, that is showing up on Google, right? So only two pages for their website are showing up, right? And outside of that, there's nothing else for people to jump on the search engines and find in order to land on their website, right? If we scroll down and we look at SEO keywords, so remember, on my website, queries are keywords, right? So these are words that people are typing into Google where my content or my website is being found. So when we look at Freetown, these are the queries that people are typing into Google that their website is popping up for. Take a look. Freetown Collective, Love Over Everything, Love Is Everything to Me, Welcome to Trinidad and Tobago Song. Those are the top queries that Freetown's website is popping up as a search result for over the last 30 days. So we know the more we understand what people want, what are the questions, what are the queries, what are people looking for online, when we create that content and we get that content on our website, that gives people more reasons to come to our website, but it also allows us, it essentially places more breadcrumbs all over the interwebs for people to type in questions or queries or keywords on Google, and we have more potential to show up as a result. When we're not creating web content, then we're going to get low traffic to our platform and we just reduce our chances of being discovered, all right? And again, this matters more as newer artists or artists that don't have a budget, right? We need to employ a lot more of these tactics so that we don't have to spend money on ads, right? Let's take a look at this. So I'm looking at the actual keyword Freetown Collective and how many people have Googled Freetown Collective in the US. And I also did a search for Trinidad. So in the US over the last 30 days, 110 people have Googled Freetown Collective, right? And we can see that of the 110 people, everybody that searched for Freetown Collective, everybody clicked through to something that they found on Freetown Collective. And we can also see the age breakdown of the people searching for Freetown Collective. So it's split between 35 to 44 and 45 to 54. And then we could also see what are some of the queries that people are typing into Google, right? That is generating a result. Like, what are some of the other things that people are searching for with the words Freetown Collective? So they're looking for things like Freetown Collective Feel the Love, Freetown Collective Wikipedia, Freetown Collective Ocean, Freetown Collective Members, Freetown Collective Where I Am lyrics, right? So you always want to pay attention to what people are searching for within your niche, not just your name, but within your niche. That way you can create the right content to drive traffic back to your platform, right? Just looking at the time, I don't want to run too deep, but that's a little breakdown of Freetown Collective. So I kind of wanted to show you, that's a very beautifully designed website, but even though it's beautifully designed, right, I would love to see more content on that platform so they can start to really drive traffic back to their platform. And once they start to get traffic to their platform, then that's going to open up to new ways of monetization. And the reason I wanted to kind of get into this part is because this is the monetization segment, right? So we're going to be talking monetization, then we're going to be going into Q&A, all right? So let's look at a few different ways artists and creatives can monetize in the digital age. And I'm going to refer back to Freetown Collective throughout this conversation as well, right? So number one, Google AdSense. So Google AdSense is, you could apply for Google AdSense. You can add the codes to your website. And essentially that would allow Google to run ads on their website. And then you could get paid out. Now, the key to Google AdSense is you got to get traffic to your website. So check this out. On average, over 10,000 website visitors per month will get you about $100 payout, right? So if 10,000 people just come to your website, right, then you can get a payout of Google AdSense. Now, there's different metrics that they factor. Different countries have different variables and whatnot. But on general average, 10,000 is that lucky number that you want to get in order to get $100 US payout, right? Now, 50,000 visitors on average will get you a $1,400 payout in the category of arts and culture in Latin America and CARICOM. So Freetown Collective is a big household name, right? I would be pushing my audience to constantly check out my website. I would be pumping content on our website because I would want to get that Google AdSense payout. So you could get paid out from Google AdSense for the content on your website, and then you can get paid out from Google on your YouTube channel, because in the entire Caribbean, we can get paid with Google. I mean, sorry, not Google. We can get paid from YouTube for the content we post on YouTube, right? So you can get paid out from your website. You can get paid out from YouTube. Those are two channels as Google cutting you checks in US dollars, in US dollars. Remember, them US dollars do mighty fine in the entire Caribbean region. They go further here. So you can get, I mean, if you don't want to have ads on your website, no problem. Another tactic that you can do is if you don't want to let Google run their ads, you can create sections on your website. And when you're getting a lot of traffic, people are going to reach out and are going to ask you if they can sponsor content. You can give them a little section on your website. They can create the dimensions for their ad, and then we could link it back to whatever they want to link it to, and you could charge them a monthly fee. Right? If I'm Freetown Collective, I'm charging you at least a little 2,000 TT to run a little ad on my website. At bare minimum, right? But again, all of that is dependent on the traffic that you're getting to your website. If you're not getting traffic to your website, then you can't really leverage because no one's coming to your platform. So why would somebody advertise to a place that nobody's coming to? But that is great real estate for you to monetize, right? Your website. I touched on this already. YouTube monetization. The entire Caribbean is fully eligible for YouTube monetization. You can receive the funds via check or direct deposit into your bank account, all right? We have guys here in Trinidad not leaving Sando and getting direct deposits from Google, all right? For you to monetize Google, you have to have 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 watch hours in the last 365 days in order to be eligible for monetization, all right? Wonderful. Then paid live streaming. Remember, digital means scale. You can charge a small fee and allow your audience to support you. So if I'm an artist, I'm not waiting on gigs. When I'm creating songs, when I'm writing songs, I would do private sessions while I'm writing. If I'm a painter, I would do private sessions while I'm painting. If I am a, photographer, I would do private editing sessions. And let people come in and charge a small fee, $10 to come and watch one of your creative, one of your favorite creatives do what they do in private, things that they would lock out the world for. If they decide, hey, I'm going to be editing some photos today, come join me. It's a live event. It's only available for 50 people and charge, $10 or $20 or whatever. Charge people to come in and limit the amount of people that come in and give them a private experience. You can do that. Don't just wait for the gigs and don't just be going Instagram living all the time. Like, you're giving away ways that you could monetize. Sure, give free stuff, give free content, give access. But also, people want to support you, but you, the creative, need to create ways for people to support you, right? So I would do private sessions of me editing or whatever you're doing, whatever your vibe is, do some private digital sessions, invite people in, charge a fee. People want to support you, and that's a way for you to make money while doing what you do, right? Outside of just waiting for gigs. Number four, content subscription. Services like Patreon, Facebook subscriptions allow your audience to subscribe to you for content. Now, not everybody's eligible for Facebook subscriptions, but that's something that's going to be coming out once you're eligible for it. I don't have the requirements offhand, but once you're eligible for it, then you could sign up for Facebook subscriptions and then people can subscribe to your content. But things like Patreon, Buy Me a Coffee. You could have you could set up a PayPal link. You could set up a if you guys have WePay, even if it's personal, right? You could set up a personal WePay account, and WePay will give you a payment link, and that link people can click on and then put in how much money they want to donate to you, and then donate to you. So if you're doing free live streams, I would pay in my link, and then people can donate money to me. But if you're using things like Patreon or whatever, Patreon is a subscription-based service where people can subscribe monthly at whatever fee that you decide to choose, and then you can give those people exclusive content. Check that out. Dive more into the requirements and see if it's something that's right for you. But that's a good strategy, getting people to subscribe to your content and you putting out exclusive content only available for them, or give it to them first before you give it out to the rest of the world. Next up, drop shipping merch. You could sign up with services like Printful or Teespring and create a web store with your merch. Focus on promoting and they will deliver your merch anywhere in the world. So create the designs, get them on Teespring, get them on Printful, and people can go and purchase your merch. And those platforms handle all of the logistics, the printing and logistics, getting them shipped out to the entire world. You as a creative just have to focus on letting people know, hey, you want to get this hoodie? Or look at this. I got my own Hustle and Motivate hats, right? You can go and get these services to create them for you. And then they can go out and get it printed, get them done, and ship out anywhere in the world, right? So drop shipping merch is another great way for you to earn some additional income. Last but not least, affiliate sales. Focus on creating the content and learn how to make affiliate sales a part of your lifestyle. Everything from what you wear to what you use may be eligible for affiliate sales through various partners. The biggest affiliate marketing partner or vendor in the world is Amazon. So anytime I'm talking about the books that I read, the equipment that I use, anytime I'm talking about anything, my vitamins, right? Anything. When people ask me, hey, what's the name of that book again? I jump into Amazon, I grab my affiliate link, and I send it to them. That way, when they purchase it, I make a commission off of that sale. So as you are building your community and people are seeing, yo, you're using that mic. Yo, what camera are you using? What phone you are using? What book you're using? What nail clipper you're using, right? Let me give you guys an example of how that works, right? So I jump in Amazon. Let's just say somebody said, yo, Mr. Rose, your nails are immaculate. What nail clipper do you use? I can go into Amazon. I can say, well, yo, I use a special nail clipper. And grab that nail clipper, go up to my Amazon associates, grab the link, right? Hold on, let me show it to you guys. It's coming. Hold on. My internet, of course, is here we go. Grab that link and I could send it to you. And if you purchase that nail clipper because you want your fingers and your toenails to look like mine, once you click on that link and make the purchase, then I would make a commission off that sale. And Amazon has a wide variety of different payouts for different items. Some items have all the items have different payouts. They fall into different categories. Some are higher than others. But everything that you can think of, right? So books, vitamins, anything on Amazon is available for affiliates. And the goal with affiliate marketing is to talk about the things that you are doing on everyday life. So again, if I am talking about a book, if I'm reading a book, somebody will always ask me, hey, what book is that? Right? And I could go and say, oh, that book is, right now I'm reading How to Do the Work by Dr. Nicola Pera, right? That's the book I'm reading. I can go grab that book, grab the affiliate link, and go and send it. Anything that's on Amazon is available for affiliates. Even local people that have put their books on Amazon and whatnot, or local products, anybody using Amazon, we can get affiliate sales. So let's just say one of your friends right here in Trinidad, their book is on Amazon, or their goods, their whatever they're doing is on Amazon. You could grab the affiliate link and send it to whoever, talk about it. And anytime someone purchases that product, you would make a commission off your own friend's stuff. Your friend still gets paid the full amount, right? But you would make a commission for making the recommendation. That way everybody wins. So make affiliate marketing a part of your daily practice. Okay. So here are the action steps as we wrap up and get into the Q&A. Here are the action steps, right? Number one, focus on building your digital home. Get your domain name bare minimum. Everybody should jump on namecheap.com. Go look up their domain names. Go grab your domain name. Secure your domain name. Get your domain name. Focus on building your website, right? There's tons of different website builders out there. I use WordPress mainly because it works with all of the Caribbean payment gateways. So it works with WePay. It works with First Atlantic Commerce. It works with PayPal. Like if I ever want to use PayPal, or if I want to use any payment gateway, WordPress works. If you are using something like Wix, or using Shopify, or using Squarespace, some of these platforms, the Caribbean payment processors do not work. So you have to make sure that whatever platform you're using, make sure you can get paid from that platform, all right? Even if you're not trying to do e-commerce right now, you don't want to be in a position where you decided to use a platform that does not work with a Caribbean payment gateway, and then you finally grow your business or you grow your brand, and now you want to do stuff, but you realize that, wait a minute, I can't get paid from the platform I have chosen. So make sure that you can get paid from the platform. You want to start collecting email addresses, build your notification list, your SMS list, convert social media traffic into traffic that you own, right? So once people come from social media and they come over to my email list, I now own that relationship. That data is mine. The second thing I want you guys to focus on is Become a content factory. Start creating meaningful content. Document your journey and process. Showcase the behind the scenes. Create content on platforms that give you the furthest reach and allow you to monetize in a variety of ways, right? Some people are just big on Twitter. Cool, like Twitter has its use, but understand that the shelf life of Twitter content is very low. You want to ensure that your bases are covered, that you create content that can be found long after the social media shelf life wears off, right? Third thing I want you guys to focus on as action steps is create products and services and initiatives that support your brand and can generate revenue for your brand. If the only product you have to sell is your music or your performance or the actual art, right? Then you will continue to run into problems generating revenue to power your brand. Start thinking of your brand as a business. All right. Now, let us get into the Q&A. But before we get into the Q&A, like if you guys want to find me, more information, follow me on social media. It's Keron Rose at any platform, Instagram, LinkedIn. Those are the two platforms I'm most active on, right? Check out my website, keronrose.com. I'm always putting out content to help you build your digital presence and monetize. And you guys could always email me as well. That being said, let us get into the Q&A portion of today. All right. Let me see. So I'm just scrolling through, right? Which domain names work with Caribbean payment processors? So that's okay. A domain name is a URL address. What you're looking at is what website builder, what content management system. So we pay First Atlantic Commerce. Those two payment gateways, those are our two core payment gateways, right? Things like, if you're in Jamaica, things like Sagicor, their payment gateway, NCB's payment gateway, again, if you're in Jamaica, all those four payment gateways, they all work with WordPress. That's the one universal platform that every single payment gateway in the Caribbean works for. Shopify only works with First Atlantic Commerce, but again, there's a bit of a process and there's fees for if you're going to use Shopify and you're going to use First Atlantic Commerce. Wix uses a platform called Tillopay and First Atlantic Commerce. So there's a bit of a process to get paid with Wix, but Wix does use Tillopay and First Atlantic Commerce. You guys can Google that. You guys will see it as well. There's different fees to get that working on Wix. Squarespace doesn't work with any Caribbean payment gateway. It will only work with PayPal, right? And if you don't have access to PayPal, and I don't recommend anybody in the Caribbean rely on just PayPal, right? Because if PayPal freezes you out or they don't give you the money or there's a dispute, you don't really have much service. I would focus on building my website on a gateway, on a platform that allows me to get paid, right? So WordPress works with all Caribbean payment gateways. Shopify does work with First Atlantic Commerce. Wix does work with Tillopay and First Atlantic Commerce, and Squarespace doesn't work with any Caribbean payment gateway, right? Let's check this out. Let's see. Let's look. More questions. Melly said, just claimed my business. Yo, listen, let me drop a bomb for Melly. Melly just said she just claimed my Google business. Dropping bombs for that, right? Does it work the same way if you use a third party like StreamYard, for example, to go live in terms of algorithms and monetizing? Yeah, because StreamYard is just a tool to produce the live, but we're streaming out. So as of right now, I'm using StreamYards with Music TT, right? So I'm logged into StreamYard, but we are streaming out to Facebook. We are streaming out to YouTube. So StreamYards is what we would use to produce the live stream. But yes, it does work like that in terms of monetizing, because when you create the event, like when we schedule the event, we get that link to say, hey, this is a future event. Then you could go into something like Eventbrite and add the link in there. When you send out your email blast, you can include those links as well and get more people to come in and watch your live stream. All right. I'm looking for questions. Let them questions come in. Malika asks, if you're doing research to see what people are searching for around your niche, but there aren't any results, how do you decide what content to create? Well, that's a very, you know what? That's a great question. Malika, that's a great question. So here's when I'm doing my research, right? And I run into that. Two things come to mind. So I'm doing the research. I'm looking for something and I'm seeing there's no data. There's no result. There's no hits, right? No data is data. Because what that is telling you is that people are not searching for it. You have to make a judgment call. You as the expert in your space, you have to make the judgment call. You have to say, are people not searching for this because one, they don't know about it. They don't know about it to search for it. Or are they not searching for it because they have zero interest in it? Or third option, are they using a different word to describe what you're looking for? A good example is, this is a rough but good example. The word donut. In Canada and the UK, we spell donut D-O-U-G-H-N-U-T. In America, we spell it D-O-N-U-T. So let's just say I put in donut for Trinidad and I realize, wait a minute, nobody's looking for donuts. Nobody likes donuts. What if they're using another word or they're spelling it differently, right? Then you'd have to go and search for that word or you'd have to ask people what other ways people would describe what it is that you're looking for and then do your homework on those words, right? Because the data doesn't lie. If no one's searching for it, it's because no one is searching for it. You have to then determine whether or not, are they calling it something else? Are they using another word to describe it? Or are they spelling it differently? Is it that, you know, they're not searching for it because they don't know about it? Or are they not searching for it because they don't care about it? And you got to make that judgment call. All right. Questions. I'm here, folks. I'm here. I feel to dance. I feel to samba. Yo, you know what I love though? Keron Niles. Dr. Keron Niles. We share the same name. Dr. Keron Niles is in the building. Thanks again for the great feedback. Love the Freetown family. Take care, team. That is the manager for Freetown Collective. So I'm very happy that he was able to come in and see, you know, some of the information and take that. And he could go run with that and help, again, drive traffic to the platform. All of this is happening, right? So that we can continue to grow. Because the more we grow, the more we build, the more, you know, we can collectively build, the better our society is going to be overall. Right? If everybody knows how to generate their own revenue and make their own money digitally, then that means that we can rely less on the system. We can rely less on the government. We can rely less on other people to just constantly having to give it to us. Or, you know, we don't have to feel like there's no opportunity. We can create our own opportunities. So that's why I love to do events like this. And once everybody can take something and, you know, turn it into whatever or run with it, I'm good. All right. Preach, kid. We have 3 minutes left. We're cutting off at 4 o'clock. So again, put those questions in and I'll go through them. Preach, kid asks, if I decide to monetize my website, where do I start? With the creation of the content or I need to register for a special Google service? Well, that all depends on all of the, remember, I went through 6 different options of monetization, right? So you don't necessarily, when you create your website, you don't have to just wait for Google to start to monetize. I could create a website, I could create content, and I could be linking to affiliate products in the content that I create, and that's considered monetization. I could be creating content on my website and pushing people to book me for a gig or book me for a service or whatever, and that's a form of monetization. So there's tons of monetization. You don't have to wait for any service to start to monetize. Google AdSense, if you integrate it, relies on you to get traffic to your website, if that is something that you want to do. If you don't do Google AdSense, unless you say you create a space on your website for people to, you know, rent and pay you a monthly fee to put an ad there, again, that's all going to be based on the traffic that you get. But monetization can start as simple as you creating content and you have affiliate links. That's monetization. Or you creating content, people find you and they book you for your services. That's monetization as well, right? Do the payment platforms, just to add, you asked, does it start with the creation of content? Yeah, it it really does start with the creation of content, right? That's usually the go-to thing. Have your platforms, build your platforms, and then create that content to push people to towards you, right? All right. Martin says, do the payment platforms like WePay and First Atlantic work by a standard fee or percentage? Good question. WePay does not have a monthly fee. They have a transaction fee that's a percentage. So WePay is, I believe it is 3.2% in TT dollars, 3.2% per transaction, plus I think $3 per transaction. In comparison, PayPal is 5.4% per transaction in US dollars. So that's another reason why I don't like using PayPal. PayPal is 5.4% per transaction. Anytime PayPal processes your money, 5.4% gone one time. They're taking the money. WePay is, like I said, I think WePay is 3.2% in TT dollars plus the $3 per transaction. First Atlantic, FAC, the bank charges 100 US per a month for the merchant account to use First Atlantic Commerce. And then FAC charges 3% per transaction plus 25 cents in US dollars per transaction. So FAC might not be for everybody. That might be for more established people. There are benefits, pros and cons to using FAC or WePay. I won't go into that today, but that is, you know, a little bit of the fee breakdown for both of those payment gateways. Melly asks, is there any difference between cost to consider when purchasing a domain name? Any preferred service providers? I typically purchase from Namecheap. Namecheap has the largest, one of the largest directories of domain names. They also have the largest collection of branded domain names. And yes, every different type of domain name has a different fee. There are some domain names like a dot, there are some domain names that they're going to charge you, that companies charge you, or these, there's some domain names that cost like 25,000 US dollars, right? Every domain name has a different cost. So when you go on Namecheap, go check them out. They are one of the cheapest directories to purchase your domain names from, but they also have all the different branded domain names as well. All right. NJ says, I need to understand the monetization process better. What did you just explain? I need to know it much more intimately. Well, that's a whole other workshop. That's a whole other workshop, right? Because yeah, I gave you a breakdown of what can happen. What I would do is I would start to do my research. Look at what we talked about. Start to do your research so you can learn about those things more intimately. But for us, that would definitely be a whole workshop by itself, because there's a lot of mechanics that go into getting those things set up. But you have the overall idea as to what ways you can monetize are as an artiste. NJ says, what is content? Is it words? Content is anything you create. Content is pictures, videos, words. That's content, right? Content is anything that you create. Because you saw Freetown videos, but it said there wasn't content. What I was saying with Freetown Collective is that they have their staple videos that they're featuring on their website, but they don't have a post section. They don't have like a post section where they can put out, you know, blogs, embed videos or embed audio clips with a write-up. So content is pictures, words, videos. It's all of that, right? But for web content, they don't have web content on their website where they're constantly putting out content or pushing content on their website so that people can find them. And there's more than just the staple three songs that they have on their section highlighted, on their website, right? So when we create web content, so let me give you an example, right? Let me give you guys a really quick example. If we go to my website, right? Giving you guys a real quick example. When we go to my website, in my content section, right? In my content section, I'm always creating content. So this content can be a video or it could be a write-up, right? The more content I put out on my website, whether it is a blog, whether it is a video, the more ways people can find me on the search engines. That way they can connect with me. They can see the different type of content. You create more ways to be found on the search engines. All right. Oh, and I realized I didn't share my screen. I was here busy talking Oh, wait. Hold on. Right. So on the website, right, I look and see what are people searching for within my niche. I then create, whether it is a written blog post or whether it is an audio post or, you know, whether it's pictures, I'm constantly looking at what people are searching for, and then create the right content to be found on the website. So once I'm putting this content on my website, this is going to give me more opportunities to be found via Google, right? So your content, pictures, blogs, podcasts, all of that is content, but all of that, when it's on your website or embedded on your website, creates more opportunities for people to find you. So I hope that answers your question. All right. So that is about it for me, folks. You have been with me officially for 2 hours. I want to thank Music TT and the Ministry of Trade for hosting this Reverb workshop and allowing me to come in and kind of break down, you know, how to be found as an artist, different ways that we can make money and monetize. These conversations are great. They are needed. Now that the seeds have been planted, the goal now is for you to start doing your homework. A lot of the information is there. You just need to find it. And again, definitely you can connect with me on social media. You guys can reach out if you have any additional questions. I'm always posting content to teach you about building your digital presence, building your platforms. I talk about all the tools that we use. I talk about monetization. You guys can find them either on my social media, or you guys can go and check out my podcast, Digipreneur FM. And you can find that on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, any podcast directory, or go to digipreneur.fm and you could subscribe there or listen to the podcast on the website as well. And I'm always talking about, again, building from the Caribbean perspective, because the things that we look at from experts in the US or in Canada or in the UK, some of the information can't be used because we don't have the same tools or the same mechanisms, and it might need some tweaking for our particular market, right? So that's it for me, folks. I hope you guys, if you guys enjoyed it, drop some flames. Please drop some flames in the chat. Let me know that you guys enjoyed today's workshop. Please, I gotta drop everything. Let me know in the chat if you guys enjoyed it. Definitely go out, subscribe to Music TT's YouTube channel and also their Facebook channel, because they're going to be, you know, creating more workshops just like this one in a variety of different topics. You don't want to miss out, all right? That is it from me. I will say this. Let's take a little wine out. That's it for me. I'm done.